This is a story of animals and humans that live inside a unique wildlife sanctuary nourished by a little river called Chinnar. Situated in the valley of Anjanad, which literally means the land of five villages, Kandallur, Kovilur, Kirandur, Kottakambur and Marayur, the Chinnar Wildlife Sanctuary is the only one in Kerala lying in the rainshadow region of Western Ghats. River Chinnar takes its origin from the grasslands of Eravikulam National Park, situated on the northwestern side of the sanctuary. Together with the Pamba River, originating from the Thalayar Valley, it forms the life-supporting artery of the sanctuary. Of the total sanctuary area of 90 square kilometers, more than half is comprised of dry deciduous forest and scrub jungle. The rest consists mainly of riparian and hill shola forests interspersed with grasslands. A glorious day begins in the sanctuary. Over a sheet of deep orange clouds, the morning sun breaks open, bathing the entire sanctuary with its life-enriching rays. Flowers start blooming. A red-banded bulbul preens itself and prepares to face the day. Bird diversity is quite rich as well as unique in this sanctuary. Over 225 species of birds have been recorded, which includes the rare yellow-throated bulbul and the migrant lesser white-throated warbler, so far seen only in Chinnar. A morning session of casual bird watching is sure to show you birds like the peacock, white-headed babbler, hoopoe, laughing dove, Indian robin, crested hawk eagle, scarlet minivet, and the beautiful little minivet. For the visitor inclined to know more about the flora and fauna of this sanctuary, perhaps a few hours spent by the riverside would be quite rewarding. There, of course, your attention is immediately arrested by the ever-present Hanuman langurs. You can watch their antics for hours and never tire of it. Well-built males in their prime, mothers with babies clutched close to them, gamboling youngsters full of mischief. You can see them going through their lives, doing the things they do every day, day after day. From time to time, they slake their thirst in the cool, cascading waters of the stream. With them, the sanctuary is also shared by other primates like the slender loris, Nilgiri langur, and bonnet macaques. A group of these macaques can always be seen near the forest checkpost. Grooming each other is one of the activities many monkey species indulge in a great deal. This activity far exceeds the demands of cleanliness. Probably it has a vital social purpose, cementing friendships and reinforcing relationships. By midday, the temperature soars up. Sunlight filtering down through the riverine tree canopies brightens up the tree foliage in all colors and hues. Now it's rest and siesta time for the tired langurs. But certainly not for those brilliant butterflies that come to the riverside for nourishment. Many species of butterflies have the habit of congregating on riversides or other dam patches that are rich in salts and other minerals. Some are solitary feeders, but others sit shoulder to shoulder, imbibing the liquid from the ground. After the nutrients are absorbed, the liquid is immediately spurted out through their posterior. Some other species of butterflies also have the habit of absorbing valuable salts and minerals from the scat of jungle animals. It's not butterflies alone that crave for natural salts of the forest floor. Chinnar has a few natural salt licks in places like Mannala and Athithurai, which are very often frequented by elephants, spotted deer and sambar. Studies have shown that at these sites the soil is very rich in sodium, potassium, calcium and magnesium. Take an evening stroll to Kutar, where the two rivers Chinnar and Pambar meet and flow down to Amaravati. Here at the river junction, mugger crocodiles bathe in sunshine and in water. If your walk is through the river bank, you are quite likely to see bison or spotted deer or elephants that come to drink from the river. In fact, the river is a lifeline to all animals of the sanctuary. Among the land animals, elephants drink the largest quantity of water, while an average person drinks about 1 to 2 liters of water every day. An elephant takes in an amazing 200 liters. And can you imagine how much water an elephant's trunk can hold? A whopping 10 liters. A tree in the midst of these giants is not the best place for a hideout. An Indian monitor lizard leaves the area in a hurry. The floral wealth of the sanctuary is amazingly rich. About 1,000 species of plants have been recorded so far, which includes the critically endangered Albasia latami. This medium-sized tree has recently been rediscovered after a lapse of more than 100 years. The highly endangered ebony make their last stand in these forests. Commonly known as blackwood, ebony was one of the few royal trees of the erstwhile kingdom of Travancore. Some of the several species of cacti found all over the scrub jungles have colorful flowers as well as very sharp needle-like thorns. But that doesn't seem to deter the common three-striped palm squirrel from sauntering through the branches and making a meal of the delicious and succulent flower stalk. The Malabar giant squirrel, which lives in the moist deciduous forest areas of the sanctuary, seem more happy to eat the tender bark of some tree. But the Chinnar Wildlife Sanctuary owes its uniqueness to the presence of a very rare species of squirrel, the giant gristled squirrel. This dusty colored squirrel, which is not as large as the Malabar giant, is one of the rarest mammals of southern India. Its total population is not more than 500, of which about 200 are found in this sanctuary. Its body color so well merges with the tree bark that it is indeed very difficult to spot one while it is resting. Another denizen of the Chinnar forest that has cryptic coloration is a famous starred tortoise. It is largely crepuscular, spending most of the daytime well hidden in the forest. But the price for successfully using camouflage in the game of survival certainly goes to certain members of the insect world, like this tiny praying mantis lurking inside a bunch of flowers waiting for a passing prey to pounce upon. Another amazing example is the leaf insect of the Phasmida family. Its body is thin and flat, with veins and many other detailed resemblances to leaves. Limbs are irregularly shaped with papery outgrowths that look like partially eaten leaves. But even the best of camouflage defenses can be of little use when confronted with predators with sharp eyesight. A tiny flicker in the leaf insect's eye, the lizard has already spotted its prey. The leaf insect has an incredible ability to shed its limb when attacked by a predator, very much like our house lizard, which sheds its tail. Watch this in slow motion, and you can see one of its limbs already detached and in the lizard's mouth. But in this case, the secondary defense also proved futile. In the forest, nothing is wasted. One animal's leftover is another's meal. Amidst the foliage of the scrub jungle, another remarkable hunter is on the prowl. Dragonflies and grasshoppers that rest on branches simply vanish into the predator's ever-hungry mouth. This invisible predator is the Indian chameleon, and indeed, no prey can escape its very sharp eyes or its lance-like tongue that has the speed of lightning. Its eyes have the rare ability for 360-degree vision and can survey the environment independently of each other. It feeds by the ingenious method of shooting out its 14-centimeter long tongue and trapping the prey on its clubbed tip. This is done at the incredible speed of 1/16th of a second. Now, let us watch the action in slow motion. Another common lizard of the sanctuary is the forest calotis, which also employs camouflage for escaping predators. But during its breeding season, the male develops red color on its head and along the mid-back. The draco is another lizard that can glide in air as he jumps from one tree to another. Spider diversity is also quite rich in Chinnar. The funnel web spider comes out of its hiding only if a prey falls on the large sheet of silk surrounding the tunnel entry. As soon as it has been firmly seized, the spider injects digestive juices into the prey to break down its body tissues. The resultant broth is later sucked out. These large sheet-like webs are a common sight everywhere on bushes and shrubs. These are made by several small social spiders that live in colonies inside these circular webs. These are not some hairy outgrowths on tree trunks, but close relatives of spiders called harvest men. They are characterized by bodies which appear unsegmented and have extremely long and thin legs. They also have the habit of congregating in large tangled masses. This one is a spiky orb spider which builds the popular cartwheel web with spokes and spirals. The spider usually sits patiently in the center. Because of poor vision, it locates the ensnared prey by gauging the changes in the tensions of the silken threads. As we walk along the threads of time, spun over eons, we learn that our ancestors shared this land with other creatures. These stone structures called dolmens are the burial sites of the late Stone Age people who lived in these hills thousands of years ago. Here, they brought their dead, an offering to the elements and fellow beasts. The remains, along with the most important possessions of the dead, were left here forever. The prehistory of Kerala is still shrouded in obscurity. These cave paintings could be from an earlier era than that of the megalithic remains. One wonders at the creative urge in that artist who drew this. Instead of spearing a beast for food or clubbing a brother for a woman, what made him draw a picture? Or was it a housewife whiling away her leisure time? This unique tapestry of habitats is being shared by two tribes, the Muduvans and the Hilpulayas. While the Muduvans are generally confined to the mountainous upper reaches, the Hilpulayas live in the drier plains. They also differ from each other socially, culturally, and anthropologically. Though Muduvans were traditionally hunters and shifting cultivators, after the sanctuary was formed in 1984, they have been forced to sedentary agriculture patterns. Besides ragi, which used to be their staple crop, cholam, lemongrass, and a variety of tubers and vegetables are also being cultivated now. the light of literacy has reached even the Mangapara Muduva settlement, situated in the southeastern crest of the sanctuary. The hill Pulayas were basically a hunter-gatherer community, possessing rich folklore on landscape, vegetation, animals, and other local resources. They still practice their rich knowledge on the craft of traditional hut making. Both the hill tribes are even now dependent on the forests around them for their sustenance. This has varying levels of impact on the habitats. One of the chief objectives of management in Chinnar Wildlife Sanctuary is to minimize this impact and at the same time enable a sustainable means of livelihood for these communities without sacrificing their rich cultural heritage. This is a challenging task. An attempt to strike the correct balance is being sought through the strategy of eco-development program. The 11 tribal hamlets are currently associating with the forest department in the implementation of this scheme under the Kerala Forestry Project. Accordingly, participatory micro-planning has been conducted in all these hamlets and are being implemented with varying degrees of success. Ecotourism is expected to be a major income generating activity. The dry scrub jungles of Chinnar, like the wild plains of Africa, have exciting wildlife to offer to the visitor. But of course, mass tourism has its own perils. Here at Chinnar, efforts are on to strike a balance between the two seemingly conflicting interests of wildlife and human society. Like the caveman artist who painstakingly drew animals, we too could live in harmony with our fellow creatures. We will learn here that we are the custodians of this land, custodians of our future. Then, one day, we will all gather at the dawn of hope and love for our little planet.